Okay, here we go. Hey everybody, Jeff here with Resale Heroes. It's so nice to be here. I'm here with Sabrina from the magical world of thrifting. So Sabrina, if you want to just introduce yourself.
Hey everybody. Well, I am a eBay, Mercari, and Poshmark seller, but I'm mostly an eBay girl. And today we are just going to be talking about eBay sales.
Yeah, and here at Resale Heroes, we're a pretty large eBay store. We're actually top 125 in Canada, so that's pretty. Yeah, it's pretty significant.
That's awesome.
As far as volume goes, and we specialize in video games, collectibles, and all that. As far as the store is concerned, and our YouTube channel, a lot like Sabrina's, we talk about what sells, what works for us, what doesn't, and just kind of sharing our experience with you so that you can get wherever you're going faster. By kind of cheating a little bit by using our experience. So in this video, we're going to be going over a few things that sold for us recently, and we're just going to let the conversation roll with whatever comes up. And would you like me to go first, or would you like to go first?
Go for it.
All right, cool. So then I am going to share my screen doing this. So this first item, you can see it, right? Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. So this first item is just kind of funny because we recently bought a box of consoles from someone. There's like 10 consoles and we thought they were all working. We were wrong. As a matter of fact, only three of them were working, which was kind of a bummer. We're still going to make some money there. Mm-hmm. But the reason I brought this up is because this box of this game and the manual, which you can see, I mean, it's all ripped and whatever, like it's in poor condition. I mean, the box is actually pretty good. It's just kind of folded. It's not actually squished, but it was at the bottom of this box. Like this other guy who sold us the consoles thought this was garbage and he just threw it in there, but we sold this for $40 full price. And it sold like the same day that I listed it. I couldn't believe it. And so it just goes to show that even selling, and I mean, we're going to sell the broken stuff too, but selling broken stuff is still broken stuff still has value, but the randomest things, like probably just this manual for this rare game is probably $10, $15. The box is $30. The game is like $20. And when you put them all together, they're worth more, but if you part them out, they still have value. Mm-hmm. So I'm just going to X out of that one. So this next one, just a funny game. I mean, I don't know. It's an old Super Nintendo game. Zombies Ate My Neighbors. And I just thought I'd bring it up because, I mean, like any other console, some games are worth $10, $15, $20. This one was worth $65. It sold with like our 10% off sale or 8% off. So it sold like just under $60. And so with what we paid, we probably made like $40 on this after shipping. So it was a pretty good sell. And this next one, I've talked about this a bunch of times. So this is a hidden gem. Anytime you can find these, Rock Band or Guitar Hero wireless receiver or dongle, they're worth like $50 each and they're really small. Mm-hmm. So this is stuff that you can easily find in pawn shops, not around here because I've bought them all, but wherever you're from, you can find them in pawn shops or yard sales. And a lot of people think that they're worthless. So it'll usually be in the junk piles. But again, they're worth like $50. So it's just this little thing and really easy to flip. So this last one, so I'm putting together, so there's going to be three that I'm just going to show back to back. And they're all alcohol company branded items. And of course, always enjoy responsibly. But these, I'm bringing them up because these are things we've had in the store for a while and they hadn't sold. But anytime something doesn't sell in our store, I mean, eventually you kind of take notice what's been sitting there for a while. So we try to gradually reduce our price so that eventually it'll move. So I'll say that we maybe take 5 to 10% off every month or so when it doesn't sell, depending on the thing. But so this is basically a handkerchief, bandana, scarf thingy. Like I'm terrible with clothing, but basically it was an interesting item. So it's a small handkerchief, sold for $15. And we were happy to see that go. This next one. So Moosehead is a brand of Canadian beer. So this is like a beer bottle case. It's so weird. But it sold for $30. It fits a beer bottle. Someone paid $30 for it. Good to go. And this next one is a Captain Morgan. So that's, I think that's rum. Of course it's rum because they're pirates. So this is a sealed deck of playing cards with Captain Morgan, the pirate captain. And again, we got each of these items for a couple dollars each from one of our suppliers. So we would have made $10, $15 on each. And yeah, those are just some of the cool things that sold for us this week.
Okay, so I only grabbed three items. But this first one, this handsome guy right here, is the prince that goes with Elena of Avatar, which is the Disney Channel cartoon. And the reason why I wanted to bring this up is a lot of my viewers like to sell a lot of like toys. And I always like try to share what I know about selling toys.
Yeah.
Well, something that I think is really important, if this is something that anybody is interested in starting to, you know, get involved in selling toys and dolls and Barbies and whatnot, there are so many Disney dolls out there that aren't really worth much, but it's so important to learn what the Disney store dolls look like, because those ones are worth money. And if you've got a more rare character like the prince from Elena of Avatar, because I'm pretty sure when you first saw him you had no idea who he was, right?
I didn't.
Exactly. And that's what you got to look for. You got to look for these characters that are more rare. You're not going to be able to find him in the stores ever again, basically. So the only place to find these characters are on places like eBay. So I always looking for rare Disney characters to sell. And this can kind of, you can use this rule for any sort of Disney item, like any sort of collectible. What is the rare character? I mean, millions of Ariels and Belles and Cinderellas out there, but there's not very much of this Prince Gabe.
Right. And if I could just mention something that came to my mind, actually, I was looking at the price. So the prices that I was showing was in Canadian dollars, and the prices that Sabrina is showing is going to be in US dollars. So her prices, well, the prices you're seeing on the screen now are about 30% more in Canadian funds, or 30% less on my screen in American funds.
Yeah. All right. Next item up are these vintage checkered strategy hardcover books.
Cool.
And the reason why I wanted to bring these up is I don't really take my husband with me to thrift stores. He goes with me to the yard sales, but I feel like he gets kind of bored at thrift stores. And he was just like looking around and he found these. And he showed them to me. He was like, Sabrina, what do you think? And then I asked him, I was like, well, why don't you look up comps? So he tried to look up comps on them and he couldn't find anything. And then I tried to look them up and I couldn't find anything either. But the reason why I wanted to bring this up is because I think it's really important to know when to stop looking for comps. And you just need to make a decision to do something, because that store was going to close soon. Do we want to spend all our time standing there trying to find comps on something, or should we just use our best judgment and just go for it? And I think that it's really important that we find that fine line to know when our time is being spent correct. So I just told him, you know what? Let's just try it. I've never sold anything like this before. They were $3 a piece, I believe. And I was like, let's just go for it. Let's try it. And they sold for $25. We were able to ship these medium mail. So they were about $4 to ship. And I was really happy with it. I mean, it's not a huge profit, but it was just, you know, something cool. I learned about something. And I like buying vintage things because it's so cool to look at things that are so old. Like, I think that there was writing in this one. Yeah. Nice. But I think that's cool. You know, like somebody wrote that in 1958.
Yeah. And
it's like, I'm really fascinated by that kind of stuff. So, I mean, this was this was fun. It was, I learned something and we took a risk.
No, that's cool. And it's a good point that you're making, that sometimes the comps are either all over the place or they're just not there. Like the Super Mario thing that I was showing earlier that sold for $40, there were comps that was way higher than that and comps that was way lower than that. So you just have to make a judgment call sometimes. And when you're in the field, in the thrift stores or whatever, doing the yard sale, sometimes you just need to make a decision whether, you know, it's just so cool to see old books like this. It reminds me of the first purchase we ever made last year, like when we went like at yard sales. It was a book from either the 50s or the 60s of the Professional Barbers Association, basically a book this thick on how to be a barber. And it sold sometime this year. So it took like 8 months to sell, but it's just so cool to have such old books. And we have a few books that are from the 40s or whatever in our store. And it's so like, I don't know. It's interesting. To think that a book would survive that long almost. I don't know.
And then I think like when I look at the signature, I'm like, I wonder if that person's still alive. You know, it's just
yeah, maybe not, but yeah.
Maybe not, but yeah. You don't know.
Yeah, who knows? But it would be cool, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, next one. Sorry, I have to move things around a little bit.
Yeah, no problem.
Okay, Dodgers. All right, so the reason why I want to talk about this one is because I was at a yard sale and I saw these. There was just like a pile of like baby clothing that just looked like all junk, right? And I always like to skim through that kind of stuff. And the thing that makes me want to do that is I don't see other resellers doing it. So I always like look at like, what are things that I can get into that I don't think other people are doing that doesn't have as much competition. So I'll look through those baby clothes. And I found the Dodger sweater and the hat, but I wasn't sure if I wanted to buy it or not. I was just like, oh, I don't know. The hat was really dirty too. So I was just like, I'm not sure. So I just sat it back down and I continued shopping while I ended up buying a couple of things from this yard sale. And at the very, very last second, I don't know what it was, but I was just like, is it okay? Would you just throw these in there with it? And the girl was like, yeah, go ahead, take them. So I brought them home and as you could see, the hat did clean up very nicely. All I had to do was wet a towel and put a little dish soap on it and it came right off. I think it was just like dust or something. But yeah, everything cleaned up really nicely. And it sold really fast. And I think it's just, you know, and it goes back to sometimes just, you got to just make a call when you're there at these yard sales. And sometimes it's going to be a good call. Sometimes it's going to be a bad call. But I think that's such an important part of what we do and how we learn.
You got it for free, right? Like you asked for her to just give it to you.
Yeah.
So that's another thing. People nowadays, most people don't have the guts to just ask for things. And people are leaving a lot of money on the table doing this. So when you don't start a conversation asking for things, but at this point in your conversation with this person, you are already buying things. You've probably been there for 10, 20 minutes. You're kind of talking.
Yeah, we had a huge long conversation with her before we checked out. So we built up a little bit of a
rapport.
Yeah.
And then you asked and then she said yes. But even if she would have said no, you wouldn't have lost anything, right? So exactly. When you get something for free or for very little money, you know that whatever you can sell it for, you're going to make at least a little bit of profit on it. So that's cool.
Yeah. And then, but I want to tell another little story about this, right?
Okay.
So I'm not a Dodgers fan. I'm actually a Giants fan. Please, nobody, I don't want anyone to like unsubscribe to me if you don't like my team.
I'm a Toronto Blue Jays. I'm not, I can't even say I'm a fan, but they're like the only Canadian team, I think, but that's all right.
But the Giants are currently, I'm not sure when this video is going to go live, but right now, as we're filming, my team is playing the Dodgers in the playoffs.
Uh-oh.
And we were watching the game the other night, and I had this cross posted on Poshmark, and somebody sent me an offer, like, as we were watching the game. So someone was seriously watching the game and shopping for Dodgers stuff at the same time.
That's funny.
So they sent me this for their offer.
Baby. For their baby.
Yeah. And they were like probably watching the game. They're like, my baby doesn't have any Dodgers stuff. I got to find something. So I get this offer on Posh as I'm watching the game. And I look and it's an offer. So I had it listed for $20 on Posh also. Mm-hmm. And the offer was $10. And at the moment, I was just like, decline.
Yeah.
But I feel like this is and I told my husband too, joking around, I'm only declining her because she's a Dodgers fan.
Yeah.
No, I'm just kidding. That was a joke. But and then look at it. It was like a day later, it sold for full price on eBay. But I want to kind of talk to you about what you think about low offers like that, because I kind of feel like I'm all over the place. Like for me, it all depends on how I feel. I'm just being honest. Yeah. Like, I feel like so many resellers will say never decline, always counter. And for the most part, I do counter offer. But if somebody sends me an offer that is 50% or more, and that's normally 50%, I feel for me is when it's crossing the line. If it's 50% or more, sometimes I just feel like I don't want to deal with this buyer, because it's normally those types of buyers that end up being a problem down the line. Like they end up complaining about something or whatnot. So I think it just all depends on the item and how I'm feeling. But
yeah, it's funny because, there's so much to say, but it's funny because you've made a video about this in the past, and it's amazing how people who send us messages and who send us offers think that we're robots or that we're eBay. They don't realize that we're just people with feelings.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes we're tired, man. Like we work a lot more than people think. And anyways, so for us, so just today, I was telling you earlier, we got I forget if it was a $20 game or a $40 game, or I don't know what. We got an offer for $1 on a game. So, I mean, that's not even close to covering just the shipping cost. So let me start by saying this. Before you can accept, so sometimes, so much to say. So you need to know what your price point is, that kind of your ideal, but also what's the minimum that I would be willing to take, that taking it under that wouldn't really be worth my time, so that I'm willing to wait. And we've accepted a lot of 50% offers on things because sometimes we kind of mentioned earlier, sometimes comparisons aren't always correct. So sometimes our pricing isn't always spot on either, mm-hmm. But 50% is a pretty big cut. So I would say 50%, I probably would have countered. But I mean, when it's really, really, really low, so like if it's 30% of your listing price, for me, that's an obvious sign. In my head, they're not really serious. It's just like they're, I don't even know. I don't even want to give examples of what I think that is. But it depends how. So the way that it works on eBay, they send you an offer and you can counter and then they can counter and blah, blah, blah. I really don't like that game. For me, I'll be like, here's the best that I can do. So like for in this example, I have it listed for 20. they offer 10. And then I'll be like, okay, look, I just listed this. It's in really good condition. The best that I could do would be 16 or 17 because of this reason and then that reason and whatever. Thank you for your time. And then if they counter at 11, then I'll just decline. Because some people will do. Some people will do that. And that drives me a little crazy.
Yes.
But some people, though, will accept the counter offer if they're actually serious. So everybody has a different threshold on what what they're willing to deal with. But we have a lot of offers, man, on different things. And because we have like 12,000 listings or whatever. So we get maybe, I don't even know how many messages a day, 100, 200, considering some of them are offers and just whatever. But if the offer pisses you off, just move on, right? But but don't let that get to you.
Yeah, exactly.
But yeah, you just need to know what that threshold is for you, and different items have different thresholds.
Exactly. So, it depends on it largely depends on the item.
Oh, for sure. And how much you paid for them and what your listing price is and what your pricing strategy is on it and just
how long you've had it listed.
Yes. That is important also. Mm-hmm. So obviously if it's been listed for a long time, you're more willing to take, because there's something to be said about just even just recouping your investment. So for example, let's say you paid, well, you didn't pay anything for this, but let's say you would have paid $10 for it and you listed at 20, but it sits there for a year. That means you have $10 locked up. That's not regenerating and making more money. So if someone would offer you $10 in a year, you probably should take it, even if it's at a small loss, just to get the money back and to put it somewhere else where, you know, so there's something to be said about that as well.
Yeah, absolutely. There's so much. And I think I want to go back to something that you said too, that I feel like it's huge for me. Depends on how tired you are.
Yeah.
Like it was nighttime. And I've had a long day. I didn't want to do that going back and forth thing. I was just like, you know, and then also, I don't think you only sell on eBay, right?
Yes.
You don't sell. Okay. So on eBay, if someone sends you an offer, even if it's a shitty offer, it's still good for you because it helps you in the algorithm. So it's like, I'm never like mad that someone sends me an offer, right? Especially on eBay. So I always try to respond to offers on eBay because I just feel like in general, it's just good for your store to do that. But on Poshmark, it makes no difference.
You can also, buyers can also see how many offers you've received on an item, I think. If they see that you've received a few offers, but it's still up, maybe it'll motivate them to give you a better offer.
Or just buy it.
I will say, though, here's a message to sellers. So as a buyer, so I occasionally buy, don't put best offer if you're not willing to even go less than the full price. I mean, what's up with that? So like,
I know I put an offer on something like a month ago. It was listed for 20 and I offered someone 18 and then they declined it. And I was just like,
The same thing, basically similar thing happened to me. I wanted to buy a game. The guy had it for 40. I think I offered like 37 or something and he declined. Like he didn't count for it. He just declined. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm like, really? Come on. So, I mean.
But I think that sometimes eBay glitches out, especially if you use the app to post, and it turns best offer on when you don't want it on. Like I've had that issue before in the past.
It's possible. So we don't use any apps whatsoever. So I wouldn't know, but I think it just attracts attention to have best offer on. Yeah. So I wouldn't have messaged the person if it hadn't had best offer. And I ended up not buying from that person, but I could have.
Yeah. If he didn't have best offer turned on, you may have just bought it for full price then. But now it already left like a weird feeling. Like,
yeah, exactly. Buying. Where I'm like, no, you don't even want to give me, you know, 5% off. Screw that. And that's I'm going to buy it from this other guy for more money.
That's why I'm very cautious too with the just declining. I'm more inclined to decline people on Poshmark and Mercari just because I don't care about those platforms as much as I care about eBay. But that's another really good point to mention is, you know, just counter and then it's just a good customer service.
But the only time that I would really decline is if we've been bouncing back and forth and it really just feels like a waste of time. So yeah. This happens a lot for, excuse me. So we might have a game for $30, get an offer for 10. I mean, there's no way we would accept that. So then I'd counter like 26, then they're like 10.50. And then three or four offers in, I'm just like, look, 25 best price. Like, come on. We're already the lowest priced on eBay before even best offer. So like, this is a great deal. Then they'll counter at like 15 and then I decline. So, I mean, I don't decline often, but we don't have the time to be playing with these guys. Who offers a dollar for a game? It costs more just to send a letter, like an empty letter. I don't even know.
When I post video games, though, it's super rare that I will ever have best offer turned on. Because normally with video games, I will go and I'm always trying to be super competitive, not just video games, but media in general. Whenever I sell media, I always like to be super competitive and look at like what's the lowest it's going for and try to list mine for on the lower end. And because I do that, I normally don't have best offer on. It kind of, in a way too, I feel like it kind of helps me to be a little bit grounded, because let's say I have something listed for $10 and I already know this is a good price. Like as I'm, you know, looking at my comps, I know $10 is a good price and I know that someone's going to buy it. But then let's say that I have best offer turned on and then like the next day someone sends me an offer for like $7. Knowing me, I'll be like, okay, and accept it. But if I just would have been a little bit patient, I know I could get that $10. So sometimes with certain items, I don't do this with everything, but just with certain items, I know myself and I'm like, I can't have the best offer turned on because I need to get this price.
Yeah. So the magic there is to have a balance of both of those, to have kind of the ones where you're trying to squeeze the most out of it without the best offer, and the other ones where, because when you turn on best offer, theoretically speaking, you're signaling to the world that you're open to negotiation to some
degree. And eBay wants you to do it.
Right.
Yeah.
And so the positive is that it probably will sell faster at $7 than at $10, but maybe it'll sell the next day, or maybe it'll take a month or 2 months. Mm-hmm. But by having the best offer and accepting offers, it does sell more. So that's kind of why we turn best offer on all our DVDs and all our CDs, or most of them. Mm-hmm. I mean, we don't go too crazy on accepting offers, but I mean, if we get a reasonable offer, like 70%, I feel like 80% of your listed price, that's a solid offer. Like that's a good offer. I mean, obviously the more the better, but 70, it's a little low. But depending on what it is, it's still reasonable. Less than that, I mean, you're really haggling. We usually only accept lower offers like that if they buy a bunch of stuff. Mm-hmm. But you certainly don't want to have best offer on everything, because otherwise you'd be undercutting yourself on everything. And it's funny because there's a lot of stuff that's listed as best offer that people will still just pay full price. But
I'm one of those types of buyers. If I'm on eBay, because I buy on eBay all the time, I've been buying on eBay for the last 20 years. And if I see something that I want and it's a decent price, I'm just going to pull the trigger on it because I don't want someone else to come and buy it while I'm waiting for the seller to accept the offer.
Yeah, so just like you'll have the other guy who'll send the $1 $1 offer, but yeah, it's about having a balance, I think, in the store, because by accepting offers, you're creating momentum, you're getting some extra sales, and that was the reason we did it is because during the summer sales were really tight, and we wanted to have more. So we kind of lowered our pricing. We started doing sales on the weekends, which we're still doing. We had best offer on things that we normally wouldn't, just to liquidate, just to get some money out. Because
get some cash flow going.
Yeah, because we're sitting on, as of right now, we're sitting on about 200,000 worth of stuff piles of stuff that's listed. But I mean, that's money eventually. But if you can turn eventually money into today money, I mean, you can turn that $7 into another 10, 15, 20 over time. And it's just one of those things.
Yeah. And going back, I feel like it just so depends on the item.
For sure.
Like going back to that example of a DVD for $10, if I'm seeing, you know, the sell through rate on it's really good too, I'm just like, you know, I've already have it listed, or if there's not a lot of them on eBay too. Yeah. If there's like a really low supply, you know, you've got that upper ground. So sometimes I won't turn on the best offer, but with clothes, I always turn on best offer with clothing. Cause I hate storing clothes. Like I just want clothes gone. Like when I list them.
Yeah, we really don't have that much, but yeah, I get what you're saying. It's so much easier to store cards and media and just whatever. You can stack them. They don't take much space.
Oh, they're the best.
But yeah, guys, so basically that's what we wanted to go over with you today. And make sure to like and subscribe to both our channels. Go check out Sabrina, my people. Comment what you thought was interesting and what you thought was the most helpful that we shared with you today.
Yep. And go check out Resale Heroes. They're awesome. I love following you. And I've said it in our last video, I love your Instagram account. You're always posting. Cause I think it's so funny when people just post like, oh, look at all my packages going out. And you do that, but if you swipe through, you actually show everyone like what you sold, like what's in those packages. So you actually give value to what you're posting on social media. So I love following you.
When we make those posts, I take a picture of the boxes, and then I take a picture of the smaller stuff, of our big bin of stuff, and then there's a limit of 10 pictures. So then I just choose 8 of the things that sold. And then so I try to do that every couple of days. And I don't know. I thought it was,
I think it's helpful.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. So thanks for watching. Make sure you bounce around in our videos, and we'll see you next time.
Bye.